doesn't it bother you when people ask you as a woman, you know, as a journalist or as an interviewer, you really didn't sleep with this guy, even if you went to interview him? You know, my feeling about that is, it's almost as if a woman political reporter goes to interview Bill Clinton, what's the first thing she's going to be asked? She's going to be asked, did he hit on you? And if a male goes to interview Hillary Clinton, I don't think he gets asked that question. So no, I was very much a professional. I was very young. I was newly married. My husband got me involved in the business. He was much cuter than any of these guys anyway. And I was a music fan, and I fell into it. I first went on tour with Led Zeppelin, and then the Rolling Stones saw some things I wrote about Led Zeppelin in Europe, in London specifically, and they wanted me on the road with them. And then it just all kind of fell into place. You know, you have to put this in context. It was in the 70s. Things just happened then. It wasn't planned. There was no agenda. I never went to journalism school. I didn't even think I was going to be a journalist or a writer. It's just my husband had one column. He didn't want to do it anymore. He gave it to me, and the rest just kind of, as Keith Richards said, it was all a lucky accident. Led Zeppelin was the wildest band that I toured with in the 70s, and they all had American girlfriends, and their wives were back in England, and they didn't know about it. And I didn't see their wives much, so, you know, I just felt it wasn't my business. I mean, you have to understand, this was at a time when there were no cell phones, there was no internet, there was no Tumblr, Instagram, Twitter. People had private lives, and I wasn't really there to judge what people did in their sort of off hours. You know, Jimmy Page always called it his offstage antics, and it was just their extracurricular sort of sex lives, and that's not what I was there for. I was really there for the music. It was sex, drugs, and rock and roll, but I really only participated in the rock and roll. The marriage is great. I'm still married to the same guy. I mean, 43 years later. I said to Richard, I remember in 1975, do you mind if I go on the Stones tour for 6 weeks? And he said, no, go have fun, join the circus. I mean, Richard and I never had children, so we just kind of both lived that life. We were in CBGBs together every night during the entire 1974, whenever we were in New York. And he went off with Lou Reed to Germany when he was producing Lou Reed's Street Hassle. I went off on tour with a lot of bands. He went off on tour with bands. It just was very natural to us. It wasn't a thing. Oh yeah, I had dinner with Keith Richards actually about a month ago. And David Bowie and I still email each other sometimes. And I see Bono and U2 whenever they're in New York or on tour. Sadly, some of the people are not alone, you know, not alive anymore. Lou Reed died last year. Joe Strummer died. John Bonham, who was the drummer in Led Zeppelin, died. I mean, there's just, in this book, I write an awful lot about all of these experiences as they happened, as the band started from little baby bands till when they got huge. I mean, I write a lot about John Lennon because I spent a lot of time with John Lennon in the 70s. And it's interesting because when he first came to New York, he was very accessible. John and Yoko, and it was very much John and Yoko, one word. They lived on Bank Street in Greenwich Village, and they were living this sort of bohemian, beatnik life. And it just wasn't that big a deal. I was able to get to them because we had a mutual friend who was a photographer, Bob Gruen, and Yoko wanted to do some interviews with women about her record, and I did that, and she felt I was respectful enough that she brought John out from the back room in their two-room apartment at the time, like he was dessert. And also with Michael Jackson, I met him when he was 10 at his house in Encino, and we remained friendly through the years, doing a lot of interviews together, and he's no longer alive. John Lennon's no longer alive. It's like, you know, there are a lot of ghosts around. Well, John adored her, first of all, and he wanted her constantly by his side. And I think John felt very liberated, in a way, from being in the Beatles. Because in the Beatles, they had to stop touring in 1969 because no one was listening. The girls were screaming so loud, and they had to run in and out of, you know, concert halls. And I think it just got to the point where they were bored by that. They didn't want to do that. They wanted to musically grow. And then if you read my book, in the chapter about John Lennon, he talks a lot about the Beatles. And George Harrison and I did a very lengthy interview where he said that the Beatles broke up because he didn't want Paul McCartney telling him what to play anymore. So I do think that Yoko got a bad rap for that. I really do. He was so smart and so cynical and so clever and so sort of witty, and I just love talking to John. There's just a lot about that in this book. I think so. I mean, because the first time I saw Michael Jackson, I knew he was going to be the greatest entertainer in the world. I mean, I wrote about the first meeting when I thought he was 10, but he was really 12. Berry Gordy wanted him to be 2 years younger because he thought that would be cuter. And we just clicked. And he did James Brown dance steps for me around his family's pool, and I just thought he was so amazing, inquisitive, really charismatic. And I called a friend of mine and I said, this is going to be the greatest entertainer in the world. So I sensed that. I remember seeing Billy Joel at a small bar on the Upper East Side of Manhattan, and I just thought he'd be huge as well. Sometimes I'm wrong, because some of the bands I love never really made it big, but that didn't mean that they weren't great bands. No. The New York Dolls were a New York sort of glam punk band that was very associated with Max's Kansas City in the 70s. And they were thought of as the poor man's Rolling Stones. They were very sloppy. They wore sort of drag. They wore makeup. And they were amazing. I thought they were the greatest live band I ever saw. Nobody might understand this. The record sounds sloppy. They were a bunch of drug addicts, a couple of them died, they fell apart, they had bad management, but for that moment in time, they were just hilarious and very sophisticated, very, very witty. But I didn't see him between the time when it was Harvey and Corky Productions, and they were the big promoters in upstate New York and Buffalo, and in fact, in the book, in the chapter on the Stones, there's a whole thing about a backstage catered event that Harvey Weinstein invited us all to in 1975. And I reminded Harvey of that recently when I saw him, and we were hysterical about it because he certainly had quite a trajectory. So no, I missed a few years. Same with Jerry Weintraub. You know, Jerry Weintraub was the promoter for Led Zeppelin, Frank Sinatra, John Denver, Elvis Presley, and he used to travel on the plane with Led Zeppelin when we were on tour in the 70s, and then I didn't see Jerry for years, and then he did all the Ocean's 11 movies, and now I see Jerry a lot at the Vanity Fair parties. So that's really funny, because we both sort of started out with the same thing. Well, I was very friendly with Steve Rubell and Ian Traeger, and Studio 54, you have to understand, it was happening at the same time other things were happening in New York in my world. So I was at CBGB's with the punk rock band, but then the same night I might go to Studio 54 afterwards and dance. Then I go back downtown to the Mud Club or to Danceteria, or I go on tour with Led Zeppelin, and then I come back to New York and go to Studio 54. I was writing a column for the New York Post then, so Steve Rubell was extremely welcoming to me, and then we became really, really good friends, and then he went to jail, and then when he came back from jail, we taught a course together at the New School called New York Nightlife. And I loved Steve, I really did. He was just a character, and he was very, very warm. I mean, he was horrible if you couldn't get into the club. He would stand there on a box with his puffy Norma Kamali down coat, and he'd go, you, no, I don't like what you're wearing, no, you can't come in. But, you know, I was a member of the press, so it was a totally different situation. Because Andy Warhol's heyday really was the 60s, and that was really before my time, thankfully, something before my time. So I would occasionally see Andy Warhol at some parties or at Studio 54, but by the time I started going to Max's Kansas City in the 70s, Andy was no longer in the back room holding court. Andy had already moved on, and I write this in the book, Andy had already moved on to, like, the Reagans and rich people who would pay him a lot of money to paint their portraits. But Andy was close to Lou Reed, and I was very close to Lou Reed because of the Velvet Underground, and my husband produced two of his records. So I would see Andy at a party, for example. There's a photo in the book of me and Andy at a Rolling Stones party, but there's another photo that I love of me and Andy at a Lou Reed party, and he's kind of whispering in my ear, just gossiping. Andy loved gossip, and he kept a tape recorder on all the time, and he influenced a lot of us in New York to keep a tape recorder on all the time. I kept mine with me all the time. I taped all my phone conversations for a couple of years. We used to go out, Richard and I, with a video camera and tape everything, or I'd Polaroid pictures, until it just got to be too much to schlep all this stuff, you know. It wasn't fun to go out for an evening, lugging all this stuff. I was never duplicitous about anything I did. And the reason I think I engendered the kind of trust I did as a journalist is I was very upfront with everybody. I had my tape recorder on right in front of them. If somebody told me something was off the record, I turned the tape recorder off. I've always honored that. Even if somebody's dead, if they told me it was off the record, it's still off the record. You know, I have 5,000 cassette interviews, I have 6 storage spaces, I have trunks and trunks and trunks of notes, photos from the rock magazines we did, Annie Leibovitz photos from the 1975 Stones tour, memorabilia, posters, t-shirts. I mean, it's unbelievable when I think of all this stuff I've been spending a fortune to house for all these years. I'd like to just sell it, and, you know, some rich collector could just take it all off my hands. But the fact is that I was trusted by these people because I was very open about what I was after. And I was not invasive. I was not going to take advantage of anybody's bad scenes. You know, if somebody was drunk and sloppy and falling down, I didn't write that they were drunk and sloppy and falling down unless I told them I was going to write about it. And then they laughed and they said, it's okay, you can do it. I mean, the difference is I wasn't a combatant. I felt we were all in this together. We were all very young. We were all taken with this music. It changed our lives. It got us out of the house. It wasn't something that I planned as a career. I fell into it. And I wanted them to have as good a time talking to me as I had talking to them. I wasn't intimidated by them. I was a very sophisticated New York girl. A lot of these British rock musicians were farmers. You know, I thought of them as hicks, basically. I had snuck out of my house when I was 12 to go see Thelonious Monk. So when I met Mick Jagger, the first thing I said to him is, those are tacky, terrible shoes. You know, they were like rhinestone studded Papagallos or Rapettos or something. So I just had fun with it before my time. I mean, the only thing I can say about Janis Joplin is in one way she kind of helped me have this career, because I saw my husband at a Janis Joplin concert. He was emceeing and he was on the radio in New York, and I saw this really gorgeous guy with long hair. He was on NEWFM. It was at a Hunter College concert in 1969. And Richard Robinson was emceeing, and I thought, oh, this guy is really cute, and he plays great music on the radio. And so I asked a couple of people I knew who were in the music business if they knew him, and if they could get me a job with him. And I went to do his filing 3 times a week for $25 after I was substitute teaching in a Harlem school. And I married him 3 months later, and the rest of it is my rock and roll life.